like to thank everyone for attending tonight. We're going to get started with our online safety presentation. I'd like to first begin by sharing a little information about Karen. This is Karen Gale. She's an FBI victim specialist. She's been a victim specialist for the state of Iowa for 10 years. She holds a BA in communications from Pacific Lutheran University and a master's in human relations from the University of Oklahoma. Karen has been involved with victim assistance programs for over 18 years. Prior to coming to Iowa, Karen was a victim advocacy coordinator for the Army as a civilian in Alaska for 6 years, building the first victim assistance program for the Army. Karen's experience assisting victims and their families covers all types and aspects of federal crime. She works with federal victims of crime as identified by FBI special agents in crimes such as bank robberies, human trafficking, child prostitution, financial institution mortgage fraud, online sexual exploitation, kidnapping, murder cases, and mass casualty events. She coordinates assistance and resources for crime victims throughout the state of Iowa and provides comprehensive victim services to ensure all needs of her clients are met. Karen is a member of the FBI Victim Assistance Rapid Deployment Team. This team assists locals in the event of a mass casualty crimes, provides victim assistance and resources to local communities and or team utilized when mass casualties events occur, which is a federal crime. Karen works with local and state agencies, provides presentations at state and national conferences, educates schools, businesses, and area groups on a variety of topics. Karen has received many awards, coins, certificates, and achievements, and the FBI Director's Award for Distinguished Service for assisting victims of crime for her work with the families and communities in the Sandy Hook School in Newtown, Connecticut. Gives me a great honor to introduce Karen Gale. She will be sharing a topic that has really impacted schools over the last several years, and I really strongly encourage you to listen to the things that are taking place that she's sharing with you. It happens nationally, but it happens here in Indianola, Iowa. So please give her your attention. Thank you.
Kind of hard to know where to look when that stuff's being read about you, because I'm like, wow, really? Did I do all that stuff, and do I still do that stuff? I want to thank Mike for inviting me here. Can you all hear me okay at the back? Great. I've done a lot of work in Indianola. You guys probably don't see me very often, because most of the work I do is with the victims that the agents identify in the crimes that are ongoing here in Indianola. You live in a really safe town, you live in a really safe state, but the reality is absolutely every crime that you hear about nationally also happens here in Iowa. I am not here tonight to scare anyone. I know there's some young kids in the audience, and it is not my intention to instill fear. It is my intention to inform, educate, and provide opportunity to have a conversation with your parents, with your siblings, with your grandma and grandpa, all of that as we go through the presentation, and you can take that home and have conversations with other people. One of the things I like to cover before I get started is, do any of the kids in here want to work in law enforcement when they get older? Nobody. Wow. Okay, so I'm going to give you my spiel anyway. I think that if you want to work in law enforcement, it's absolutely fantastic. If you want to be a special agent in the FBI, I highly encourage you to do that. Anyone can work for the Bureau. Anybody can work for Secret Service or DEA or ATF, any of those federal agencies. So I highly encourage you to think about those kind of things, because sometimes nobody even has that conversation with you when you're thinking about what you want to do when you grow up. So if you want to be a special agent for the Bureau, you have to be 26 years of age or older. You have to have a 4-year college degree. You have to work for 3 years after you graduate from college, and you have to be willing to carry a gun. And you have to be willing to do everything that is necessary in order to carry that gun. At the Bureau, you also have to carry a top secret security clearance. So that means you have to take a polygraph test, which is more generally known as a lie detector. And when you're 26, they will go back until you were 18 and talk to people that know you and know how you behaved. The other thing is you can't have any criminal activity on your record past the age of 18. So really start thinking about that as you young people are moving through middle school and high school. You know, if you want to be an agent, a special agent for the Bureau, do it. Just stay out of trouble. That's the easiest way to do it. If you want to be a victim specialist like me, you have to have a bachelor's degree. Most of us have our master's. There's 126 of us in the United States. Iowa has one. That's me. Nebraska has one, Kathy Thompson. And then we have a gentleman by the name of Phil Kratz who covers Indian country, which borders Iowa and Nebraska, because every crime that happens on an Indian reservation is a federal crime because it's federal ground. And so we have specific victim specialists that work with that population because their needs are different and the resources and referrals are very different on Indian country versus non-Indian country territory. So also within the Bureau, anybody want to be a pilot in here? Man, be a pilot. My son's a pilot. My husband's a pilot. It's awesome to be a pilot. We have pilots in the Bureau. We have our own fleet of cars and airplanes, so that's an opportunity for you. Anybody want to be a mechanic when they leave high school? It's a great job. Absolutely. We have mechanics in the FBI. They have mechanics in the Secret Service to work on all the vehicles. So I would encourage you to really think outside the box. Anybody want to do computer stuff when they grow up? You guys are a tough crowd. All right, so you want to do computer stuff when you grow up. We need people who work on the computers in the Bureau as well. So I tell you all of this just to kind of expand the options that you think about when you're working through middle school and high school and what you want to do after that. Whether you go on to college or a trade school or you get a full-time job or you go into the military, there's a lot of different options outside the borders of Iowa. So I highly encourage you to give it a look. Like Mike said, I moved here from Alaska, and coming to Iowa was my 17th move in 24 years. And so I've seen a lot of places, I've met a lot of people, and I have a lot of different experiences. So I think everybody should get out of Iowa. You can always come back. It's a great place to live, but you need to get out and see the rest of the world as well. Another couple things that I cover before I get started. Number one, you can ask me any question that you are willing to ask in front of this audience. I tell that to the junior highs and the high schools that I go into, and believe me, I've had some pretty amazing questions asked of me by young people. You can ask me anything you want. Number two, I ask that if you have a cell phone, you turn it off or put it on vibrate. And along those lines, how many in here have cell phones? Anybody in here not have a cell phone? Oh, you guys are my favorite people. I have two cell phones. I have a Bureau phone that's on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days out of the year. That comes with my job. I knew that when I signed up. I have my personal cell phone that I get to shut off. I don't have to talk to my children. I don't have to talk to my husband if I don't want to. I don't have to talk to my parents if I don't want to. And so a lot of times my personal cell phone gets shut off. Cell phones are the bane of a lot of people's existence. I will tell you right now, I've had teachers tell me that they are the bane of the school sometimes. We're going to cover a lot of the things that you're doing on your cell phones, both the youth in the crowd and also the adults, because believe me, adults are doing some pretty shady stuff on the cell phone and online as well. The other thing that we're going to really cover as far as the presentation tonight is social media. How many in here have a Facebook? All right. How many in here are on Snapchat and Twitter and all that stuff? Okay. When I talk about social media, I'm talking about all of that, because it used to be that Facebook was the big deal, and now what we're finding is Facebook is a big deal for us old folks like me, right? And all these young kids are now moving on to other things. And some of those apps that they're working on, like Kick, anybody on Kick here? Come on, somebody in here is using Kick. No? Snapchat? Okay. Twitter? Yeah. So when you think about those things, think about your followers. Think about what pictures you're posting. Think about who's following you, who you're sending information to, who's sending information to you. And then also think about what's going on in your community. I came here from I got a new child pornography case a few weeks ago, and I met with that client here in the Indianola area tonight before I came here. Child porn is happening here in Indianola. It's happening in every city, in every state in the United States. I put some handouts at the back, and I know Mike's going to send it out in PDF form, too, when he can scan it and all that kind of stuff. One of the articles that's back there is about a sextortion case, and what that is an individual will either contact you through Facebook or some social media and ask you to send naked pictures or tell you that they have a naked picture of you and they want you to do more things. So that article back there was in Vogue magazine, or Glamour magazine. I don't read Glamour magazine, but three of the individuals that are in that case are from West Des Moines. So three 14-year-old girls, about 5 years ago, decided it would be a good idea to go on a video chat site. And on that video chat site, the expectation is that you would get naked at some point. So within the video chat site, it's a 15 to 20 minute sign up. They had 186 individuals that signed up to watch their video, and within the 20 minutes, they started out fully clothed. By the time it was over, they had gotten naked from the waist up. Unbeknownst to them, 186 people were watching when that was taking place. They thought it was just fun. They'd take a risk, you know, do this kind of stuff, and it would be over and done with. And most of the time, that's how it happens. But in this case, about 3 days later, one of those young ladies got an email from a kid who said, "Hey, I'm a 15-year-old guy. I really liked the video that you, the video chat site that you were on the other night. I watched it. It was really fun. I'd like to see more." And they got scared. They're like, "No, no more." And he said, "You don't understand. I downloaded that video as it was being made, and I've made still shots of it. So if you don't do this, this, and this," and he had a checklist, "I'm going to send it to everybody who is in your address book on your computer." So what did they do? They did it. Sure, they were scared. They didn't know how to get out of it, right? So unbeknownst to them, another young girl in Arizona had also made this same choice. But when that kid contacted her, she got scared and she went and told mom. So what'd mom do? Mom went to the cops. She had a really smart mom. So local law enforcement realized it was a computer crime, and they got the FBI involved. And it wasn't a 15 or 16-year-old young guy. It was a 27-year-old pharmacy student out of Jacksonville, Florida, who is now serving 107 years in federal prison. We identified over 250 young girls that he was sextorting online. So three of those girls were in West Des Moines. I don't know how many more girls are in Iowa or throughout the United States that we haven't identified, but we identified 250 in that case, and three of them were from Iowa that we know of. So the stuff that you're doing online is getting prosecuted. The stuff that you're hearing on the TV is happening here in Iowa. So be aware, as we go through this presentation today, all of this stuff that I'm talking about, I have experienced with the victims throughout the state of Iowa. Those three young girls that were involved in that case that I talked to you about have gone on to college. They're doing fantastic. One of the young girls' images is still online. There's nothing we can do about it. Once you send a picture, it is out there forever. I don't care if you send it to one person. It is out there forever. And if you delete it, it doesn't mean it's gone. It just means it's gone for you. I have guys that I work with and women that I work with that are really good on the computer. I suck when it comes to the computer. But they can find absolutely everything that you have deleted off of your phone, off of your pad, off of your iPad, off of your computer, all of that stuff. So really think about what you're doing, and before you hit send, think about why you're sending that stuff. So as we go through the presentation tonight, I'm going to cover all those things that I've talked about so far. This is a NetSmartz.org presentation, so you can go on to NetSmartz.org as parents and kids, and you can download portions of this presentation. There's also other videos that you can watch. It's a really good educational information site, so I would encourage you to do that. We're going to talk about all these things tonight. Anybody in here game real-time live with other people throughout the United States and around the world? Okay. Yeah, I'm not asking you questions to get you in trouble unless you're raising your hand and your parents have told you you're not supposed to be doing that. You wouldn't be in trouble with me, but I have no control over how your parents are going to react to that, okay? So a lot of kids are gaming in real time, and what we're finding is that the young kids are beating the older kids, and the older kids are getting really ticked off. And so the harassment and the inappropriate behavior and name-calling, things like that, is taking place. So we're going to talk about that a little bit, too. So what do your children do online? Anybody want to just throw out what you know your kids are doing online? YouTube, absolutely. I go on YouTube. There's so many great YouTubes. There are some horrific YouTubes as well. What else are they doing online? Are they downloading music? Yeah, there's a legal way to do that, and there's the illegal way to do that. I would highly encourage you to stay on the legal side, but yeah, absolutely. Kids are downloading music, absolutely. What else are they doing online? Are they posting pictures? Are they sending instant messages? Are they sending text messages? Yeah? Are they on the Facebook? Are they on Snapchat? Are they on Kik? All those apps that you have no idea what they do on your kid's phone? You need to look at your kid's phone. And some of you kids are going to be kind of maybe upset with me by the time you walk out of here tonight, because I was one of those really mean moms that had the password to the computer, and nobody got on the computer unless I was home. I had to check the history. My children did not get cell phones until they were 16 years of age, had a job, and could pay for their own gas when they were driving the car. That's how mean I was as a mother. So if you have it better than that, you need to thank your parents tonight when you go home. So your kids are doing all of the stuff that I'm going to talk about tonight, and some of this stuff you're not going to know that they're doing, but this is to give you the opportunity to ask different questions and to take any, is there any young child or young person in this room that earns the money that pays for their own phone in here? Awesome. Okay, so a couple of you are earning the privilege of your phone. The rest of you, your parents are paying for it, or a guardian, or an aunt, or an uncle, or however that works for you. So again, in my house, if you weren't paying for it, it was mine. So I could take that phone anytime I wanted. I could get on that computer anytime I wanted. I could access anything that my kids were doing anytime I wanted, because I was paying the bill. And that's really how my perspective is to this day. If I'm paying for it, it's mine. So we're going to talk about cyberbullying. We're going to talk about how rampant this is. I'll give you my bullying story from when I was a kid. We're going to talk about inappropriate content. It's all over the place. I mean, it's just, you can hardly open a computer anymore without seeing inappropriate content. And so we have to open the conversation between our children, what's appropriate, what's not appropriate, what's okay, what's not okay. Online predators, oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. We will never get a hold of child pornography or online sexual exploitation because of the computer. Child pornography used to be a postal crime. You had to mail it or you had to hand it to somebody. Now it's just clicks, or it's an app that runs it for you. Sexting. Holy smokes. High school, junior high and high school, sexting is a big issue. We're going to talk about that tonight, too. And I'm a really straightforward presenter. If you have a comment or a question or, you know, want to make a statement while I'm presenting, please jump right in. I will use the appropriate language. I know there's some little tots in here. I would never say anything I don't believe is inappropriate in an audience like this. So I just want to tell you, I just kind of call them as I see them. All right, so there's different risks for different age groups. I do give presentations to all age groups. I'll tell you right now, junior high is probably my favorite group to give it to because they still will ask the hard questions and they're still pretty honest. All the high schools that I've gone into have been very appropriate, but they're not going to ask the questions. They have a lot of opinion, which is fantastic, but the shift has just kind of changed. So if you have younger children, which I'm going to cover a little bit tonight, but you can go onto the NetSmartz.org website, and they actually have videos and education for little kids, like kindergarten, first, second, third graders. So it's really a good opportunity. And so that's what I look, when I give presentations, this is the kind of the categories that they're divided into. So if you were to hear, I was going into the junior high or the high school, the tweens and teens stuff is what I would be covering for them. And on the left is what I would cover for, usually fifth grade and under. All right, so how many of these myths, how many of these are really myths? Is every predator out there an old man? No. In the state of Iowa, what I know, and I talk about what I know in the state of Iowa, the cases that I have worked, the individuals that I have worked with, to include the bad guys and the bad girls, but also the clients or the victims that we identify in our cases. I've had two old, well, I don't consider it old because I'm old if I say it. So we've had two individuals that the young kids in this class or in this auditorium would probably think are old, 42 and 53. So I'm actually older than the 53-year-old, so that makes me really old. But we don't have old men. In Iowa, the average age, everything that we've seen, is between the ages of 23 and 44, okay? Average. Are predators necessarily pedophiles? No, they aren't. An online predator has a specific set of information that he wants to get across, and he is looking for a certain kind of individual. In the state of Iowa, the predators are usually male. 98% have been male. And the victims are what?
Girls.
Girls. And what age are the girls?
13 to 16.
Man, yay. You get the gold star. That's how it is. That's how it works in Iowa. That's real common across most of the 50 states as well. There are those predators that are looking for children that are much younger. There are never, I shouldn't say never, the vast majority of the time they're not looking for someone older than 16, okay? Do the predators pretend to be younger than they really are when they're soliciting them online? Most of the time, maybe. What I have found is that initially they might say they're a little bit younger than they actually are, but by the time they've got you hook, line, and sinker, you know that they're a 42 or a 53-year-old man, and you're still willing to walk out of your house at midnight to meet him. At that point, it doesn't matter because your children have already been so well groomed. That guy could be 105 and they'd still walk out of your house. So the predators that are out there are really, really good at what they do. And are they abducting these children? No. These kids are walking out of their house under their own volition. They're saying, yes, I want to meet you. Yes, you're my good friend. Yes, you listen to the same music as I do. Yes, you like to eat pizza just like I do. Yes, we can go play video games. They're saying yes because those predators that are out there are really good at grooming them and getting inside their head and making them think that they are their best friend in the whole world. And nobody understands them better than that person. So they don't have to abduct them. And that's not what's happening in Iowa either. Okay, this is stuff we've covered already. I think the one that's really hardest for a lot of parents to understand is that they rarely lie about their age. Because if you lie to somebody, how are they going to trust you? So even the predator themselves isn't willing to lie to you about age or anything initially. Now, are they going to lie to you that they love you and they only want to hang out with you? Absolutely. Because in nobody's book should a 42-year-old male be asking a 12- or 13-year-old female to meet them and not tell anybody about it. Because they're not going to hang out with you and buy you new clothes. That's not the real reason they're coming to see your children. The real reason they're coming to see your children is to sexually assault them. So we need to get very clear that your children might say, oh, he was such a nice guy, and he bought me all these nice things, and you know, we really could be good friends, and blah, blah, blah. The reality is, the number one thing they want to do is sexually assault your child. And it happens on a daily basis. Who are the victims? This very intelligent young lady down here told us, 13 to 16, 13 to 15, same difference, absolutely. Mostly girls, but there is a percentage of boys. And sometimes it's really challenging for the young boys to come forward, especially if it's a sexually based crime, to ask for help. It's really difficult. If you think about it, if you report a crime, what happens next? Hard work, right? You have to tell the police officer or whoever you're talking to what has happened, when it happened, where did they touch you, what, you know, all of that happens. And so it's really challenging to have your kids report a crime, but you have to be willing to have that conversation with them and tell them, if anyone makes you feel weird, if anyone touches you inappropriately, if you're ever in a situation where you've met somebody online and things are getting out of control, come and talk to me. I'm your mom. I'm your dad. I'm your grandparents. I'm your pastor at church. I'm your teacher. I'm the vice principal of your church, of your school. Talk to a trusted adult and tell your children that. If you're not telling them that, the bad guy's going to tell them, oh, don't talk to your parents. Your parents don't know what they're doing. You and I know each other. You and I like the same music. You and I need to meet. If you're not having that conversation with your children, the bad guy or the bad girl is going to be. So as you do this and as your kids are moving forward, you know, I was a teenager once, way back in the Stone Age. And back then, the reality was, what was that? The Stone Age?
Joke.
Okay, awesome.
Inside joke.
Inside joke, awesome. So back then, I'll tell you the risky behavior that we did. And yeah, I'm like I said, I'm a really straightforward presenter. I might flash somebody really quick as we're driving by in the car, but we didn't have cell phones. We didn't have video capability. Or we would moon somebody. You guys know what mooning is, right? Okay. So that was risky behavior back in the day for us. Anymore, I think about that and I think two things. One, my behind or my front may have been all over the internet if I was that stupid to do it back then with the cell phones, or I would be in trouble for doing something stupid online. So I didn't have to worry about that when I was a kid. You guys have to worry about that. You as parents have to worry about what your children are doing online. And the law has not caught up to where the computer is yet. I mean, there's lots of really good law out there, and the FBI and your local authorities are really working it as best they can. But the reality is, you need to do your own policing of your own children and what they're doing online. So you need to click it again, and then the video will play.
The internet, it's a tool that has to be used properly. You know, it's like a knife. I mean, it's very helpful, but it can also cut you. My name is Julie. When I was 13, I started talking to Tom. He didn't act or even sound like a 56-year-old man. So he was different on the computer. I knew that I wasn't supposed to be talking to him, but I did it out of a retaliation against my parents. It felt nice to have somebody who wasn't always trying to tell you what to do. It started to get more like a relationship where it went from just friends to best friends, more personal relationship than best friends. I would instant message him between 3 and 6 hours a day. I was really upset whenever I couldn't get on the internet because I knew that he would be like, "What were you doing?" And he emailed me like 10 times wondering where I was at. Then you feel like extremely bad about it. It was an opportunity for him to manipulate more. I trusted him more than anybody else. He mentioned, "Wouldn't it be nice if we were together all the time?" And then the thought came up of running away. The night I left, I kissed all my brothers goodnight, and he was in his truck, and we just rode out. I ran away for 3 weeks. The day that I was found, we were on our way to Reno. Somebody reported us and saw our truck. I knew pretty much it's over. And I mean, I never really thought the day would come. He's going to be in jail for 25 years. He sent a letter to me saying that it was my fault and that he was going to kill me if he ever got out of jail. I was really upset because he didn't say anything about caring about me. I didn't think of his background, and I didn't apply it to myself, and so maybe he could have done anything to me, even killed me. And so, you know, now that I'm back, I feel like there's this huge emptiness inside of me. If I could have talked to people, maybe I would have had a different view on some things. If you're planning to run away, it doesn't help solve anything. If it does anything, it makes it worse. Little things can end up becoming a big thing. I kind of wish that I never would have run away in the first place. I would never do it again.
So that's the conversation you need to be having with your kids. Why is it a good idea to walk out of your house at midnight and meet someone that you've only ever had a conversation with online? I have a 12-year-old little girl up in Minneapolis, well, in southern Minnesota, that met a 52-year-old pedophile sexual predator from the state of Iowa, and he is on the sex offender registry. Had been in jail twice for that, and then he contacted this little girl through Facebook or one of the social media sites that she was on. And he traveled to Minnesota, and he had her go and wait in the park for him. And rather than get on the school bus, she walked to the park. She got in a vehicle with him, and they went to a local hotel after he stopped at McDonald's and fed her. The school called mom because the daughter was absent from school. And the mom's like, she shouldn't be absent from school. She left the house to get on the school bus. So, of course, mom is like, oh, my gosh, where's my child? So she calls the little girl. The little girl had a phone. 12-year-old had a phone. The little girl answers the phone because she sees it's mom. And mom says, where are you? Oh, I'm with a friend. The guy takes the phone and hangs up. So, of course, mom's in a complete state of panic, goes to law enforcement. The guy who had driven from Iowa to meet this little girl is in a state of panic. He drops her off at a local shopping center with her phone. She calls her mom. He hightails it back to Iowa. And then law enforcement did what they needed to do in Minnesota, worked with DCI and the Bureau, and we identified who he was. So that 52-year-old crossed the state line to go and see that 12-year-old, and that 12-year-old willingly walked to the park and got into his car and drove away with him. So this is happening here. These are 12 and 13, 14, 15-year-old girls and boys who are making these choices to walk away from what they know, thinking that they're going to go to somebody that knows them better or wants to have a better spot in their life with them. So think about that as a parent. And think about how that grooming happens. You need to talk about your kids, about how other skills that other people are going to utilize against them to groom them, to get them to like that other adult better than you. There are times I really didn't like my parents. There are many times that my children really didn't like me. And that's how it works. But if you've had this conversation, if you've opened up the opportunity to talk to your kids about, you know, yeah, you and I might not always see eye to eye, but just because that person tells you everything you want to hear online doesn't mean that they're a nice person. And it doesn't mean that they're necessarily who they're representing themselves as. So really think about it. These bad guys and bad girls online talk to each other. They write books about it. They have their own websites. They are really good at what they do, and that's why they're accessing your children online and being very successful with it. So think about the conversations you can be having with your kids. Think about the amount of time your child's on their computer or their phone, because their phone's basically a computer now, too. Like I said, I was a really mean mom. You had to have homework done. You had to have your chores done. Yeah, I made my kids do chores. I know, slave labor. That's the way it worked. So all of those things had to be done in order for them to have their phone or to work on the computer. Your children need to talk to your children about the time that they're spending on the computer. Of the adults in this room, when you were between the ages of 12 and 15, how many times did you sit still for 4 to 6 hours a day other than school? Did you ever do that? No. You were either running around outside, you were messing with your brother or sister, you were causing trouble, you were hanging out with your best friend, but you weren't online. The average amount of time that a child spends online outside of school is anywhere from 3 to 6 hours a day. Where are you as parents? I'm not going to talk to you about your parenting ability, I'm just asking. Because if your child's up in their room on their computer for 2 or 3 hours after school, you need to know what they're doing online. And they may be chatting with their friends. They may be doing all that. But I would highly encourage you to be nosy and see what they're really doing online. If they get really mad when they can't be online, or if you take their cell phone away, oh well. Just have the conversation, please, because every single week I get the new cases. I have an 11-year-old boy in Independence, Iowa, that I'm going to go see. He was talking to a 41-year-old man online and got that 41-year-old man got him to send naked pictures of himself. These are 11-year-old boys. Have the conversation with your children. What's appropriate? What's not appropriate? Why are you online so much? What are the rules in your family or in your home as to when you can be online? We were talking earlier about, my daughter is a clinical psychologist at Gillette Children's Hospital up in Minneapolis. And there is talk now about having a diagnosis for addiction to the computer or to the phone. That is how rewiring of the brain is happening through these computers and electronics. So the only real way, as far as I can see it in layman's term, I am not a psychologist, I think my daughter went into psychology to try to figure her mother out, but I am not a psychologist. But it makes sense that if you're so addicted, and even as adults, if you think about it, how many times you check your phone a day? Or you think you hear it buzz? Or you think you hear it beep? And it doesn't. That's another thing that's happening, you know, that repetition of vibration or the repetition of sound. Or if have it ever happened to you where you're in the grocery store or in the mall and you hear your phone ring, but it's somebody else's phone that has the same ringer as you? And you're like, oh my God, who has my phone? Nobody has your phone. Your phone's in your purse. It just happened to be ringing. So really think about those kind of things in your family, because if you can help offset some of that stuff, you can debase the grooming that's happening. You can interrupt that. You need to be the one who's having those conversations with the kids. You need to be the one who we're all in together watching some show or playing a family game night or whatever that looks like to break that cycle of that electronic connection. I tell you to talk to your kids. Sometimes it's easier said than done. Obviously, I'm somebody who talks a lot, and I talked a lot to my kids, and eventually they would do this because it was me saying the same thing over and over and over again. But at least they knew what was coming then. They knew that I had said that to them probably 1,000 times before. And I'm just hoping that the one thing that they needed to hear, they remembered when they got scared, when they were on their own, when they were in the mall, when they were on a date and it wasn't going well and they wanted to call home. They knew that could happen. The other thing I want to put down and debunk right now is that cell phone is not going to keep your child safe. And I say that in the context of, if someone is taking your child will not have the opportunity to call someone. The cell phone does beep off of towers, absolutely. But the reality is, abduction happens so infrequently, that's not going to help your child anyway. The reality of that phone is if they're driving somewhere and they get a flat tire, they can call for help. That's how that phone can help keep them safe. You can touch base with family members. You can do those kind of things. But if you're relying on that phone as the one source to keep your child safe, I would not instill in your children to do that. They need to stay in constant contact with you if they're not, you know, at home, or if you don't know where they are. If they're late, you know, you call in every 10 minutes or whatever that curfew looks like, all of that kind of stuff. Do not put so much faith in that phone that you think that phone's going to keep your kids safe. It's just not going to happen. Now, your children can use that to ask for help and get assistance, but in the long run, the people that are going to help you are other adults, and the police, and people that you know and trust. Those are the people that are really going to help your kids. Okay? So when I talked about reporting crime and how much hard work it is, because once you make the report, you have to talk to people about it, and you have to tell what happened. Cybercrime can be just as challenging, but people don't want to tell other people about it. So this is one of the opportunities that you have. You can make a crime report at the Cyber Tip Line website, and you can make an anonymous report if you want to. And I tell this to young kids because sometimes they're too afraid or ashamed or unsure of what to do. And one of the reasons that my three girls in West Des Moines were successful in getting assistance and getting out of that cycle of Chancellor asking them for more naked pictures of themselves was because that young girl in Arizona made a report. So if you are being harassed online, or even if adults are being harassed online, and you make a report and you tell the information anonymously, that goes into a database, and that might be able to help offset someone else being harmed or help embolden the law enforcement opportunity to find more evidence and find more connections between the crime. That's really what happened when the young girl in Arizona made the report to her mother, and that's why Chancellor is in jail for 107 years of his life. Okay? Because sometimes it's hard to make the report. But these are the reasons that you do it. So, let's talk about what you're doing on your cell phone. How many pictures with your cell phone in here? Oh, come on. I take tons of pictures on my cell phone. Everybody takes pictures on their cell phone. Some of the cell phone cameras are really, really great. I mean, they take some fabulous pictures. There's nothing wrong with that. I don't want you to be afraid of your electronics. What I want you to do is question why you're doing some of the things you're doing online. Your pictures of your family and friends, if you were to take a selfie with me, let's say, I know nobody wants to do that, but let's just say you did, and you're like, hey, could I put your picture on my Facebook page? I would let you put my picture on your Facebook page in your selfie, but I wouldn't let you put my full name on there. If you text me, or not text me, if you friend me on my Facebook page, you're not going to be my friend. My rule of my Facebook page is I have to know you in person, and I have to like you. So I'm kind of a Facebook loser. I have like 97 friends. And I am totally fine with that because I know all 97 friends. I'm a lot older than the vast majority of you in here. And I have had 12, 13, actually I even had a 9-year-old tell me that he had over 1,200 friends on his Facebook page. It's impossible, people, to know, as a 9-year-old, to know 1,200 people in real life. What are you doing adding them to your Facebook page? That tells me two things. One, he's not being monitored. And two, his Facebook page is not set to private. So think about that. Think about if you're taking pictures or you're having, you're having fun and you're taking snapshots and you're going to post things, you need to ask people if you can post their information. Some people don't want their stuff out there. Some of it has to do with if you have friends or parents are in law enforcement. You know, I work for the FBI. Big whoop-de-doo, right? But if I was an agent for the FBI, it would be very different, I think, for me, as far as information and pictures and knowledge that's out there. Same with law enforcement. Same with, you know, some people who work in certain areas don't want all that information out there. So be considerate and ask the question. And that's when you can reveal the information that people tell you you can. What's too much information? If you are taking sexually explicit pictures of yourself and you are under the age of 18, you are both producing, and if you send them, you're distributing child pornography. One image puts you in jail, federal jail, for 10 years. So there's a smattering of young people in this room, and there are probably a few, I don't know, young people who have taken sexually explicit pictures of themselves on their phone. Risky behavior, absolutely. If you take that picture on your phone and you're thinking about sending it to somebody, rethink that. Because when do you have control over that picture? Before you send it. Absolutely. And adults, too. Adults do stupid stuff online. I don't, you know, as an adult, if you're over the age of 18, you can take naked pictures of yourself if you want to, and you can send them to other adults who are over the age of 18 if they want them. But the reality is, why are you doing that? Why do you think that's so important to do that? Think about those images and who it could affect, not other adults. Heaven forbid your kid picks up your phone and you've got some wild and crazy photo on there. Some of that stuff can't be unseen, mom and dad. I'm just telling you. Believe me, I'm just telling you. So think about the inappropriate pictures you're taking. Think about the information that you're putting out there. If you have a Facebook page, if you're on Snapchat, if you're on all of those new apps, if you're on Kick, all of that stuff. Why? You don't need your date of birth out there. You don't need a cell phone number out there. You don't need any of that stuff out there because your friends know that stuff. They know when you were born. They have all the information that they need. If you have a Facebook page, cull it out. You don't need all that information on your Facebook page. You need to be safe, and this is the way you can be safe. All right, so, you know, I go in and talk to a lot of schools, and schools have gotten really great about not putting full names of kids on the photos, because it's great to go to your school website and see your child, whether they're in band or track or the debate team or whatever that looks like. It's cool to see your kids' pictures out there. But schools have gotten really good, not only about identity theft, but also the safety of their own children. So, you know, they might put your first name with your capital letter of your last name. I don't know how you guys do it. Is that how you do it, Mike? But that's just safekeeping stuff. So don't blow that by sending out all your information to anybody who's on your 1,200, you know, Facebook friends, okay? Your cell phone number. Right now, there is no way I can look up your cell phone number. You know, like in back in the day, you had, we still have phone books, but the reality is there's no phone directory for your cell phone number yet. Eventually, I think that's going to happen. So if you don't give your cell phone number out to somebody, they don't have it. If I gave my cell phone number out other than my work phone, I ask people, don't share that with anybody unless you ask me first. I've already got enough crazy people calling me on my personal phone trying to sell me crap. I don't need any other people calling me, okay? So just think about that and think about what information you don't want out there. Talk to your kids about what information they can share. You know, have those kind of chats with them. Who are you giving the cell phone number out to? Who are you, you know, talking on Snapchat with or who on Kick? Nobody has the Kick app in here. Or nobody's willing to tell me they have the Kick app in here. And so it is an app that we have just found so many young kids end up getting, making really poor choices and getting in trouble on the Kick app. It's a social media site. People can access you through that. So every day there's a new app out there, and your kids are going to be trying new apps. So that's another reason you need to have a look at their phone. You need to talk to them about what's appropriate and what's not appropriate. Passwords. And I talk a little bit about this too, like if you have a debit card and you let your child take the debit card and you have, you know, obviously the debit number to go to the ATM or whatever that looks like for you as a parent, that's a pretty sacred number. You need to have a conversation about not sharing passwords and not sharing debit card numbers, not only for safety and security of your money, but also identity theft and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, that can happen too while we're online. And then the other thing that happens all the time in schools, we make some really poor choices. And so having the conversation with your children about what they do and the choices that they make, the drinking, the drugs, the hate speech, all of that kind of stuff, it's just, you need to have that as you're sitting around at the dinner table, you're driving to their sporting event, or you're driving to church, have a topic of conversation one night and have it be, what do you think about bullying? What do you think about swearing? What do you think about... And just have that 5 to 10 minute conversation where you can hear what their opinions are, you can tell them what your expectations are, and then you move on to something else. It opens up opportunity for conversation. Okay? And then just click it one more time. There we go.
Hey, I'm Eduardo. I'm a junior at NHS. I'm not anything special. Pretty normal. I get good grades, and my friends are pretty cool.
What's up, Eddie?
And even my parents aren't too bad.
We love you, mijo.
I also do a little swimming. Actually, some recruiters have been checking me out. I'm hoping to get a scholarship for college, so my parents don't have to worry too much about tuition. Last week was a championship meet, and it was awesome. Our team owned it, and I set a school record in freestyle. Someone from the team decided to throw a party, and it was crazy. Everyone from school was there, including the hot girl from my science class.
Hey, Eddie.
People were acting so crazy, I had to take them pictures, man. I may have had a little too much fun. It probably wasn't the smartest thing to take pictures, but then I got really dumb and posted them on my page. It's just what everyone does. And I didn't even think to use my privacy settings. So once I posted them, everyone could see them, and anyone could share them. I found that out when I was called to the principal's office and saw some of the pictures from my page sitting on her desk. Coach was there too, and he was really disappointed. It seems like one of my so-called friends had sent them the pictures, but which one? It could have been anybody. My ex-girlfriend, who's always mad at me for something. One of my teammates, who seemed kind of jealous. It could have even been some guy I spoke to once in the 9th grade. I guess it doesn't even matter, because I'm the one who put the pictures up there in the first place. Now my principal's saying that I violated the student athlete code of conduct. I signed it at the beginning of the year, and it's zero tolerance. Meaning, no more chances. I'm off the team, goodbye scholarship. On top of that, I got suspended. I've never seen my parents so mad. Even my teammates won't talk to me. Some of them were in those pictures, and they've been called into the principal's office too. At first, I was really mad at whoever sent the pictures. What business was it of theirs? But then, I realized that as soon as I posted the pictures online, I made it their business. It was really all me. I was two kinds of stupid. I was the one who broke the rules. And then I posted the pictures online. It was one mistake after another. So that's my story. I used to be this kid, and now I'm this kid. And this was all it took.
It's all it takes is one click. And that's all it takes for that bad guy or bad girl to access you too. So think about that stuff as we go through. Again, it's about talking. It's about having the conversations. It's about all that stuff that we've already discussed here tonight. All right, we're going to talk about sexting for a minute. People get really uncomfortable with the sex word and all that kind of stuff, especially young kids. And that's fine. That's appropriate. It's, you know, people get nervous. They move around. The reality is sexting is rampant in junior high and high school. And what it is, it's sexually explicit pictures of boys and girls, and they're sharing them with everybody else. It goes back to, you know, when I was talking about mooning and those kind of things. It says here 4% of teens have sexted. I would venture to guess, I mean, this presentation is older, and so I would venture to guess we're probably at 25 to 30% of kids who have made that choice of taking a sexually explicit picture of themselves and sending it. And 15% say they've received a text. I would venture to guess it's much higher than that as well. And go back to that little tidbit of information that I gave you. What kind of crime is a sexually explicit picture of a child under the age of 18? It's a federal crime, right? And it's child pornography. And we have the biggest increase as far as child porn goes is self-production. And what that means is the kids are making child porn of themselves. It is a multi-billion dollar industry. They are making tons of money off the naked pictures of young girls and young boys. And some of those kids are now making that same choice and doing that for themselves. Does not negate the fact that it's illegal and it's a federal crime. I do not know a U.S. attorney or an assistant U.S. attorney in the state of Iowa right now that's going to prosecute 12, 13, 14, 15-year-old girls and boys for doing this, but eventually that will happen. Education is a big key. Information is a big key. And taking responsibility for that and not breaking the law is a huge portion and part and parcel of that. So, having said all of that, every single person in this room now knows what a federal crime it is to self-produce or to have a sexually explicit picture of a minor on your phone or to distribute it, right? So everybody's educated now. So the young people in this room, when you hear of your friends taking those kind of photos, you need to have a conversation with them about how much trouble they could get in and what risky behavior that is, okay? A lot of times it's boyfriend and girlfriend doing it, you know, sending a sexually explicit picture of yourself. Some of that's rite of passage stuff, some of that's normal adolescent behavior, but you have to have the conversation about how it can go bad very quickly. Yep, one more.
Send that to me real quick.
So that's the little brother. That's you as a parent. And that's that friend of a friend of a friend you have on Facebook. So again, when do you have the opportunity to stop all of that? Before you send it. Absolutely. I pound this in every single time I give a presentation because kids and adults are making really, really poor choices about the pictures that they're taking and who they're sending them to. And you saw how rapidly that stuff spreads, right? You've seen that with instant messages or, you know, with rumors and all that kind of stuff. It takes one click to send that photo. So really think about it before you hit that button because the humiliation alone We've had to deal with young people making the choice of killing themselves because they've been bullied so badly by that, by the humiliation that takes place after that picture makes the rounds at school. The other thing is, when you get the police involved, it needs to happen. I mean, if that's what's happening, if an individual is soliciting you online and you've sent sexually explicit pictures of yourself or they've requested that, law enforcement needs to be involved. And if they're doing it amongst the high school, law enforcement needs to be involved because the reality is it's against the law. And all these other things that are listed up here then can happen and can take place. And it puts everybody in a really bad position. So think about those pictures that you're taking. And you know what? You as parents need to have the conversation about what's okay and what's not okay. I mean, you get to make the choices about what you talk about as far as the sexual relationships that are taking place amongst junior high, high school, and above and beyond. So have those conversations. It's uncomfortable. Believe me, my children were so uncomfortable with it. I wasn't, but they were totally uncomfortable with it. But if you don't have that conversation with them, somebody else is going to. So you need to have that with them. So, cyberbullying. Wow. How many adults in this room were bullied as a kid besides me? So young people in this room, look around. If the adults who were bullied would keep their hands up. Every adult in this room who was bullied as a kid obviously is now doing well, is thriving, lives in Indianola, Iowa, is doing okay. But every adult in this room can tell you who bullied them. For me, it was Joel Johnson. I was in fifth grade. I went to Longfellow School in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. I was 10 years old. That's 44 years ago. I can still see Joel Johnson's face. I can still hear the words he said to me. I can still feel the punch that he used to give me in my stomach. And I will never, as long as I live, I will never forget my mother, who was 4'11", making me get in the car after getting the school directory that was an identity theft nightmare back in the day, because it had everybody's name, telephone number, address, where they worked, all that stuff. And we went to Joel Johnson's house. And my mother knocked on the door, or rang the doorbell, actually. And Mrs. Johnson, I don't know what her name is today, Mrs. Johnson, came to the door. She was huge. My mother's 4'11". I was about that high, that tall in fifth grade, too. And this woman was huge. She probably was 5'6", like my height. And my mother told her, "Your son's bullying my daughter, and I want it to stop." And what happened? It stopped. Because an adult had interceded on my behalf. That's what has to happen. But the reality is, I could go home and never have to see Joel Johnson until the next day at school, right? But your kids aren't going home and leaving the cyberbullying back at school. Those cyberbullies are accessing your children on a daily basis through their phone, through their social media, all of that stuff. And it's hurtful, and it's humiliating, and it is overwhelming to your children. So if you think your child's being bullied, or even if you don't think your child's being bullied, maybe you have a child who is a bully. You need to have that conversation about what is appropriate and is not appropriate as far as interacting with other people. So there's a, will you click it one more time, please? So these are, I have a video coming up that I want to give a little preference to before we show it. Cyberbullying, this is all encompassing. This is all this stuff. It's not just about saying mean things about a girl or a boy or to each other. It's all of this stuff. We're talking about the fight videos. We were talking about YouTube earlier and how, you know, there's so many great YouTube videos out there, but there are some really horrific YouTube videos out there too. And those are being produced by young people who are sitting there videotaping other kids getting the crap kicked out of them and then putting it on YouTube. Rather than being part of the solution and calling law enforcement or trying to do something about it, they're standing there videotaping it. So embarrassing pictures, threatening, harassing comments, all of that stuff is encompassed in cyberbullying. The big piece of it is now they're accessing them through their electronic media, and they can never get away with it or get away from it, and it is so overwhelming to the youth of today. So it really becomes much more all-encompassing, and it follows them to school, it follows them home, it follows them to church, it follows them to practice, all that kind of stuff. So we need to open up that conversation about why it's not okay to talk about the hate stuff, or why it's not okay to harass people to the level of hate. What do all of these kids have in common? Any? Pardon? Right. This young lady said it. All of these children committed suicide. And why did they commit suicide? They were cyberbullied. Absolutely. It is suicide amongst teens under the age of 16 is increasing on a yearly basis. And it's because of things like this, cyberbullying, sexting, the interaction as far as the electronic media goes. So we need to think about why we think it's such a great idea to be so tuned in and so turned on to the electronic media and social media sites. So this is the Amanda Todd video. This video, don't click it yet, please. This video is only music, and Amanda Todd is going to flip cards. There's some young kids here. It might be uncomfortable for you to watch this. You have every right to get up and walk out if it's too uncomfortable for you. Amanda Todd made this video not long before she killed herself. It is a very powerful video. And parents, if you've never seen it, have any of the parents in here seen this before? It is very powerful. And I encourage you to watch it. I encourage you to have a conversation with your children tonight or tomorrow if they have questions about it. But if anybody gets uncomfortable, please feel free to get up and walk out, and you can come back in after the video is done.
For a heart so big, God will. wouldn't let it live. May angels lead you in. Here you meet my friends. Upon sleepless roads, the sleepless go. May angels lead you in.
The reality is every single person in this auditorium is valuable. You're valuable to yourself. You're valuable to your siblings, to your parents, to your friends. And if that bully out there is making you feel less than valuable, you need to tell somebody about it. And if you know someone who's being bullied and you know who the bully is, you need to tell somebody about it. Because every single child, just like Amanda Todd, deserves to get on with the rest of their lives. And so the one way we can do that is we open up the conversation about suicide, about cyberbullying, about sexting, about all of the things that are risky behavior, that are uncomfortable to talk about and uncomfortable to listen to, in order to have every single person, young person in this room, grow up and be one of those kids that, as the adults did in this room, raise their hand and say, you know what, I'm still alive, that bully was mean to me, but he didn't get the best of me. You need to have those conversations with your children. You need to talk about the things. And you know what? Everybody here is already open to the opportunity of talking about all this stuff with their parents or with their kids. So you need to talk to your neighbors, and you need to talk to your Girl Scout troop leaders, and you need to talk to your coaches, and you need to talk to your pastors, and you need to talk to your school teachers. You need to talk to everybody else, because everybody needs to hear it. And the vast majority of people in this room probably already know a lot of the stuff that I've talked about, but to reinstill that in all of your friends and in your neighborhood safeguards everybody. And that's really what it's all about, is to take care of everybody else as well, not only ourselves. And if you have a child that's being bullied or is having a hard time working through some of this stuff, have them talk to a counselor. If they're not willing to talk to you, have them talk to a counselor. Talk to the principals and the vice principals at your school. Talk to the counselors at your school. If they don't want to see somebody in the school system, there's plenty of people within Indianola or the Des Moines area that work with children through these kind of challenging times all the time. And making that choice and doing the right thing is much easier. The first step's always hard, but it becomes easier and easier. And if the bullying does reach the point of harassment, don't delete any of your text messages. Contact local law enforcement. You can change numbers and all of that kind of stuff. But if it reaches the level where law enforcement needs to get involved, Iowa law enforcement is phenomenal. They get it. They understand it. They're willing to listen to you. They're willing to do what it takes. They're going to start at the lowest of levels to try to help offset it and get it to stop. But then they're willing to work through the steps in the process, too, to make it stop. And if you think you have a kid who's a bully, you need to think about what they're doing online, why they act the way they do. Have you represented yourself as a bully? How do you interact with other adults? How do you interact at sporting events? How do you interact, you know, in social media with other adults? Because most of our children behave as we behave. Even though we don't want them to necessarily, they're watching you. And if you're bullying other adults, happens all the time. Happens in the workplace, happens, you know, on the playground, happens wherever. Adults can be bullies too, it's not only kids. We've talked about all of this stuff, and we're coming to the end of my presentation. Go ahead and click through. Again, I can't reiterate enough to you, have a conversation about anything with your kid. If something comes on the news, oh, what do you think about that? Open up the conversation of all of this, because that's the way you're going to safeguard your children, and that's the way they're going to move through the rest of their lives, being able to ask questions and ask for assistance and be productive members of society. Obviously, take care of your computer stuff. Make sure you have all the right firewalls up and the safeguarding of the right software and all of that. I am not a computer guru at all. I still call my son, who's 28 years old now, and say, Kyle, this is happening on the computer. He's like, oh, mom, you know. So the reality is you have to kind of safeguard your computer, too, and make sure that your security features are up to date. Okay, so that's really the end of my presentation. I am happy to entertain any and all questions. I know that I've kept you about 10 minutes long. But if you have a question or a comment, Yes.
Like Phil Donahue. Okay. And one of the things that I never thought about that was brought up is, and I see this, parents do this, kids do this, and I probably did it too with my kids. When your kid gets their permit, how you maybe show them with their permit, and there's, think about what's on your driver's license. So, guys, I see a lot of middle schoolers in here. When you get your permit when you're 14, a lot of you will take a picture and put it, hey, I'm driving, and you put it on Instagram. Well, there's a lot of personal information on that, so be very, very careful. Another thing that they brought up, and I see this at the high school, is kids will post their schedules, and hey, who's got a class with me third period? Well, think what's on that schedule. Lots of times your name, your address. So just little things like that you don't think about. So think about what you're posting. You don't want that personal information out there. So.
Yeah, great. Absolutely. Yes.
I don't want to talk anymore.
Okay.
So I've actually been told that if you take a picture and you post it on any like social media, that pedophiles or whatever, that they can actually take your picture and figure out where you live just from your picture.
Well, there's such a thing called geomapping. Yeah, and a lot of times now I don't, and I'm not a techie. Remember this. I know that when you take a photo, it shows date, time, and location because of the app that's already on your phone. So then if you post that and you haven't disabled that app, and correct me if I'm wrong, anybody in here, if you haven't disabled that app, there are other apps that can decode that in the picture itself.
Because I've been told that they can pinpoint it down to the room that you're in your house.
I don't know about that, but I do know with all of that mapping that's associated with the images that you take on your phone, if you don't disconnect that, it can happen, absolutely. Anything else? Comments? Questions?
I will make a comment. All the things that were mentioned today by Karen have happened here in Indianola. We've worked with cases. Officer Keller is in the back. He's showed up a little after some training, showed up a little late for the presentation, but he's been in the back watching the presentation. He's been through the presentation before. He's been a strong advocate for our community on safety, on online safety, sexting, all the different aspects that have been mentioned. And so there's another resource for you. I don't know, Justin, do you want to talk a little bit about what's been going on in Indianola? But like I said, these are things that I deal with Officer Keller more often than you want to know. And the more we as a community that can come together and really work on this, I think the better we are.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. O'Meara. Yeah, I'm a detective at the Indianola Police Department, and I'm also assigned to the Internet Crimes Task Force for the state of Iowa. And like Mr. O'Meara said, this is stuff we do see on a regular basis here in Indianola. A lot of things you may see in a presentation or videos and you think, oh, you know, that's happening in big cities, Chicago, New York, Des Moines, whatever. It's happening here in Indianola. I've got several cases on my desk right now involving all of this stuff. Just this summer, we dealt with a 13-year-old girl who left the state with somebody that she just met online. So it happens to your children, it happens to your grandchildren. And so this type of stuff is the stuff that needs to be happening. There needs to be more education. I would be happy to speak with any of your groups, church-related, community-related, whatever. Give us a call. I know she would love to speak with any groups as well. Some of the things that I see here in Indianola, one of the big things, obviously, is sexting. At the middle school level, we've seen a big increase just in the last year or two in sexting. And it's not just pictures going back between girlfriend and boyfriend. It's then being spread to several other friends after that. And so that video portrays it so well. You have that first choice to make of who you're going to send that to. After that, the decision's out of your hands. And that's what we've been seeing a lot of just specifically this year, where pictures will be taken and then spread to several other individuals after that. The other thing is, I know the application kick has been mentioned. That's probably in 90% of my cases is the kick app. And some of these apps are friendly to law enforcement. Some apps are not friendly to law enforcement. And some of these apps are outside of the United States, which don't have to abide by our laws. And so when we're trying to help your child and we send legal service, search warrants, subpoenas, to try to get information on the suspect, some of these apps we're not able to do it because they're not within the jurisdiction of the United States of America. So that's when it comes down to you as parents, know the apps, know what you're allowing your kids to get on. Tonight, I just spent about an hour at firearms qualification. Before I get to use my firearm, I have to go through training. And then even after I get my firearm, I have to go through training constantly throughout the year. But yet, oftentimes we hand our kids an Apple iPhone with no training at all. And this is a weapon that can hurt your child very severely. And so before you hand this to your child, they need to know what's right, what's not right. They need to know what to do if something happens that shouldn't be going on, whether it was them that made a mistake or whether it's somebody that's trying to contact them inappropriately. They need to know all of that stuff before they ever get this in their hands. And I think that's where a lot of parents are kind of missing the boat, is they're giving them the technology without the training beforehand. I don't want to go on and on, but the only other thing I wanted to mention, some of the apps that we've been seeing, I mentioned this to Mr. O'Meara on one of our recent cases, there are apps now that hide information. Kids, plug your ears for a minute. I'm just kidding. The kids probably already know all this. Parents, there are apps that make it look like the app is something else, specifically a calculator. They could make it look like any other app. And what it really is an application that hides photos. And so, looks like a calculator, functions like a calculator. They enter in a certain passcode, and guess what? It's a photo vault that actually hides all the images that they've been receiving and sending. They can also chat back and forth between people in those apps. And so don't just assume that, oh, it's just a calculator. You guys need to be involved to the level that if an app gets downloaded on that phone, you guys need to know what that app is, how they're using it, and why it's being used. So I say this just because I've seen it on several phones now in some of the cases that I've just recently worked. And so it is here in Indianola. Kids are using those apps. Kids are hiding things on those apps. And you as parents need to know that and be aware of it. So I'm at the police department here in Indianola. You want to get a hold of me, stop up there, get in touch with me, get a hold of Mr. Romero. He's got my contact information as well.
I just want to know, is there a source to know what apps these are? Is there a website that we can look into?
This is what I just did while she was talking, because just looked it up. I just said, what are the apps out there to hide photos? And it came up with 7 secret apps to hide photos. So just Google. Okay. It'll tell you all the things that you need to know. The number one is Keep Safe. Keep Safe. Do you guys know what Keep Safe is? Have you guys heard of that? Yeah, some of you. So, yeah, just Google it. You're going to find that information just like we will. So.
Is enough of this being presented to the kids in the school? I mean, we may not hear about it when coming home to us. I'm just wondering what is being presented to our kids. Are they getting this much information?
I can tell you right now, I've been out to the middle school, and I've been to the high school before here. I know that you do a phenomenal job of education, but there's just not enough people out there doing it. It's a requirement in Iowa that you have to train it, but there's only so much time in the day, and there's only so many opportunities. And so that's why, I implore upon every adult in this room, you need to tell at least 1 to 5 other adults that you know about this information. Go to netsmarts.org, do all that kind of stuff. Talk to local law enforcement. The reality is, it's an overwhelming amount of information. But if you just break it down into small bites, you're going to be able to do a great good for your children. You know, and I literally, I'm going to Winterset, I'm going to I-35 next week, there's only one of me, but, you know, I talk about it all the time, and that's what you have to do, you just have to have that conversation. And local law enforcement goes out all the time to schools, and they're providing trainings. It's just so much out there, and the kids are so ahead of us, you know, we're playing catch up, so.
The middle school this year is using a curriculum called Second Step, and they're using that in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, and it's a program dedicated to a lot of this stuff. Cyberbullying, bullying in general, how to interact, how to respond to, how to be resilient, how to respond in an appropriate manner, how to be assertive, how to not be a bystander, how to take part. So a lot of those skills are trying to be developed as well.
Craig, you might know more about the high school. But at the high school, we have advisories. And Joy, we do bullying and that kind of stuff once a month at least. We also had a freshman jumpstart program that kind of talked about the etiquettes of using the computers and stuff, because we are a one-to-one here at the high school. Last year, we did have a time that we did show, we concentrated on bullying, and we talked to the freshmen why the other people took some tests and things like that. So we do things here, but I will tell you, as we're standing here right now, something new is happening on the internet that we have no clue that probably 3 or 4 weeks from now is some kid is going to find it and is going to start something new, because things are popping up as fast as, I mean, as long as we just stand here. I will tell you at the high school, too, that if you guys can manage your kids, a lot of our problems that we have with our kids when it comes to conflict, most of them start on social media. And it starts at social media at home, at work, at the park. I mean, they're all over the place. And then they bring it to school. And a lot of times it's premeditated fight or whatever, saying, I'm going to meet you here. And it's all on Facebook. So... And the funny thing is they'll show us these things, and of course we hand them all over to the police, and all of a sudden, you know, nothing's a secret anymore for anybody. So,
yeah, it's true.
So we are talking, probably not as much as we can, but.
Mike spoke of the Second Step curriculum, and at the elementary level, we have been implementing that same curriculum for the past 2 to 3 years. So even at the kindergarten level, we're talking with kids about how to be assertive, how to not be a bystander, how to help support your friends when they're having difficulty with other peers around them, either on the playground or on the bus. So that curriculum, that same message, kids will be hearing all the way from kindergarten through eighth grade, so we're pretty excited about that.
That is happening in all elementary schools.
Awesome.
Let's give her a warm applause for her efforts tonight. And thank you. Your care and your involvement means the world to me and to everybody in here. So thank you. Keep doing what you're doing, because it really makes a difference. Thank you once again.